are still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja, and our guest today is Dr. Tom Okrut, the Executive Director, National Environment Management Authority. Doctor, we were still looking at your tenure in office, but one other thing that intrigues me. When I was coming in today, I saw a very big banner of Say No to Kavira. During your tenure, or it hasn't happened in the lifetime of Uganda to be able for government to be able to ban Kavira, the use of Kavira. But government was very emphatic during your tenure that there should be stop on the use of Kavira, and you seem to be failing.
Well, you could be right, not also right. Yes. You see, when there's a way government works, and certain things, because there are some policy shifts that occur. You are right, at that time, it was in the law that was existing, which had had a lot of, before I came in, there was a lot of postponement, negotiations, when to start and whatever, okay? So when I came in, I discussed the characters, said, no, let's set a date. From such and such a date, we shall not have Kavira. So there's a lot of petitions and what, there are a lot of interest groups. So we started really, basically, we collected Kavira, we almost removed about 22 metric tons. We even had a license with a company in Luero there to do the incineration of the Kavira that was coming. We went through Mbarara, Busia, people were collecting. Then there was the petitions by those people. We went to court, took us to court. We went to court first. And the court.
The manufacturers.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So we were halted first to do our work. So again, as a government institution, we don't disobey court orders. So we had to stop first. So battle that and got it out of court. But then also government said, okay, maybe let us, can we get a size? Because at that time for us was everything covered. So we started comparing other countries, what are they doing, whatever. But you know, there were shifts. Globally most countries, we're also experiencing the same, because plastic manufacturing, plastic carrier bags, is a big business. So if you find the UK, they put it there, we are going to start in 3 years, we're going to start it, then they keep changing because of the pressures and whatever. But of course now, if you look at the science, the plastics are now the biggest public health issue, because now it's found in water, it's able to enter in your bloodstream, the microplastics. So now, the rethinking is coming again. So however, for us here in government, there was a discussion that maybe let us have a certain size below which we don't want to get. Then we also introduced that the companies that are here in Uganda must be able to recycle, they must be able to label, and they must have a policy of collecting the poison bag from the public for recycling. So that came in and was now put in the law, which came out last year, 2019.
Is it being enforced?
So now the enforcement has begun. It is, of course, the law came into effect in June last year, among so many things. That one, we started enforcing it because they said, okay, for the sizes, that's the manufacturing thing. Let the Bureau of Standards be responsible to ensure that the manufacturers comply to that. But for the other larger component, that's what we're doing. So we are now in the field right now to look at those industries which don't have recycling plants. We are going to close, we are closing them. And then we're giving notice to most of them to start labeling their Kavira, their depositing a brick, so that is from Nicholas and Sohan Company. So that Nicholas and Sohan Company should be able to respond or to trace back and collect this waste. So they're able to, they're going now to establish collection centers, supermarkets where the people can return the poison bags and whatever. So that's where we are now in the policy, implementing that law and policy. It went through that. So the total ban which was there in the previous law was amended. Now we have a size of 30 microns and above, yeah. So that's where we are. But for us as a regulator here in NEMA, we ban it.
You burn it, but we
for
still
use, yeah.
Yeah, for use, for your use.
But again,
but outside of
again, the again, as you said before, in countries that have succeeded, the public are the first people to say no, because there are ones who go to a market and you are given 10 caveras to carry a few things, whatever. So they should know we've gone through the public. We actually went through various, even through the meat packers, we've met those people, trained your people when they come to buy meat, they should come with the buckets. It's all bags which are so, don't use cavera, because the science is there, what things are happening. We've done that. But through public, actually again, probably again, we didn't do continuously, but we needed to do it continuously, so that you have a choice to say, no, I don't want cavera. So say no to cavera. Mm-hmm. It's an individual choice.
It's an individual choice.
So if the public was, in all those partner countries, when we are comparing notes, the public said no. And once the public says no, the industry has no power to force.
Maybe we've not yet sunk low to the extent of understanding the magnitude of the challenge of using cavera.
Maybe. But we've explained. We've brought the science out, explained. What we've in cases here now, what cases are doing, all those white people where women cook food, they used to cover the food with the cavera. The cavera just breaks down into small parts. And you know that cavera, when you get it, is very soft. Now the softness means that some of the things have gone into the food, and then cancer increases. We've explained that.
Doctor, one of the biggest challenges that this country has suffered in terms of environmental degradation has been the increasing water levels in Lake Victoria. But surprisingly, the government insists that it will not compensate people that were affected while living on the lake shores. Do you think this is fair? But also, secondly, what is exactly, probably your viewer out there would want to understand, what causes the increase of water levels in the Lake Victoria Basin?
Okay, thank you. Let me start with the increase in water levels. Over the last year, I think you've been living here, the water which is coming into Lake Victoria comes from Kenya, comes from Tanzania, comes from Rwanda and Burundi. That is inflowing water. And there is only one outlet at Jinja to get that water out. Uganda also adds more water through this one as you go to Masaka. Small things like this one on the Kivu Channel.
Streams,
whatever. So Uganda's contribution is really little. Rizzi, whatever, that's small contribution to the Nile. To the water in the lake. So what has been happening is that for a long time, the lake is very large, about 69,000 square kilometers. It also rains in the lake. When it rains in Kalangala or Kluzira, it's also raining directly on the lake. Eh? So we are saying that the water that falls in the lake is equal to the water that goes through evaporation. And the water that comes from the rivers is what was in total getting out. Eh? But last year, we've been having rain here consistently. December, when we were supposed to have dry season, we had heavy rains. January, we were supposed to have dry season, heavy rains. February, when we have supposed to have a dry season, heavy rains. Now, the presence of heavy rains means that the amount of water going by evaporation was less. So that water also stayed around. The water coming from, meanwhile, the rainfall pattern in those countries, also including Ghana, increased. Kagera was bringing about 5 times its normal. Kenya almost 6 times more. So all that water came. And the only thing to do is to increase outlets from Jinja, which was done almost 6 times to try to get water. Because the prediction says, the weatherman says, no, more rain is coming. About half a meter of water is coming. So please get space. So that's what we're hovering around. So,
but you seem to be failing on the residents of Panda Pier.
No, let me come around. That's what you're asking. What happened now? Now that came in. Now, from what we know here, Panda Pier, Mulungu Beach, and all these places, because the water of the lake for a long time went away, so people moved in. But we have contours before. We have where the water stopped. before 1964. So we have been telling people to evacuate those places, Panapia, Bugolobi, and whatever, all those places. We have been telling them to vacate their areas for a long time. Don't settle there. Those are actually places of not living, to get living there. So when the water came, it went there. This is not river water. Now it's the water in the lake. River water, you can wait for the rain after 2 hours. This one's not going away. And if the science is correct, up to 2023. So you cannot say you're going to continue living there. So the best bet is leave. You're in a lake bed. You are inside the lake. That's what the government are saying. So, and they are not going to compensate you for choosing to go and live inside the lake. Yeah. That's why the government is not compensating. They're just encouraging you to leave that place and come out.
Maybe that would be part of the problem. I mean, these are livelihoods that are being distorted. If you're saying you're not going to compensate them, where are they going to go?
Is it compensating? That means that there's some exchange. You went to... Actually, the people there should be the ones to compensate the government for having stayed in government land for the time they have been in the dry land. Because that is property of the government. They went there, lived freely. Now there's a catastrophe. They say, government, compensate me. No, it doesn't work.
But you see, it acts as an incentive to lure them away.
No, the government can only do things that encourage them, say, okay, maybe we can give you some places to go somewhere and settle.
And probably that's what they're looking for. And I would say that could be part of the reason as to why you're failing on Panda Pi.
No, the OPM is responsible for that. They are trying to arrange for that. So that at the appropriate time, people can leave. You cannot continue living there underwater. I mean, you are not a frog. And cholera is around the corner. All those diseases are going to come. So, Banang, if you're Ugandan, now you're waiting for government, and then these diseases come on you there? No, it's not correct. Mosquitoes and whatever. Now, the same thing has happened in Lake Yoga. Because this water went, and Lake Yoga and Lake Albert are more affected even than here. So what has happened here? People refuse to move. Crocodiles came now. I said, okay, now you're our food. So people have just left. So why do you remain there to be eaten by a crocodile? It's good here that we don't have crocodiles on this side of the lake. But you go to Mayuge side, on that side, there people left because another enemy was now becoming nearer you. Okay? So for the people here, I think, of course, the issue is that there is a government, those are citizens. It must take responsibility on them. There's no doubt about that. That's what I think they are trying to find out. How can this help the citizens? But not to compensate them. Compensation is the wrong word. Compensating is mine. You are taking mine, compensate me for this. But no. These people were told, not today, several years, that don't go and build there. But again, you know, like what I was talking about, local government thing, the LCs transact business. But the LC is not staying there. He's staying very far. It is you who's staying there, sleeping on a bed. Now we've gone there, people are here. There's a bed made half a meter of water below. You are sleeping there, that I'm not living here. This is my house. So we shall leave you there. But we are saying that the water of the lake is not going to disappear. The people of UNMA, the Meteorological Authority, have told us more rain is predicted in the East African region. And the science predictions indicate that this weather condition is going to plume in until 2023. So are you going to stay there for all those years? It's better to relocate now.
But Doctor, for us growing up, Luera was the biggest water catchment area. It seems to be encroached on right now. The expansion is huge. You see miles and miles of rice growing in Luera. Are you sleeping on the job? No. Because the fear is that probably if Luera goes, then we are left with nothing.
No, the rice farm there, we approved it. So we're not sleeping on the job. No, but also if you recall, that particular part of Luera, did it have water?
But if it had papyrus, then it should have had water.
It didn't have water. Those are places where you'd get mounds of, let's say, anthills. So many there. And it was a grazing land. Very marginal soil, useless.
But it's not only that. It's not only the rice that is being...
But I'm trying to... You started with the rice. I'm trying to explain to you. So some guy said we can convert that marginal land into productive land. Marginal land to productive land. How are we going to do irrigation? We're going to put fertilizer and whatever. I said, okay, try. The rice growing here is no different from what is happening in eastern Uganda. Only that people here are not used to large rice growing. If you go to Kibimba, Kibimba is a regulated rice growing scheme. Doho is a regulated rice scheme, regulated, where a lot of rice is grown under regulated conditions. Similarly, also here, that rice farm was licensed to produce rice under regulated conditions so that we know how much fertilizer you're going, how much water you're producing, and you're producing 24/7. That person has converted that marginal land, those mounds and which used to be there, into productive land. With employment, with production of rice, Lukaya town is no longer the same as before, and there. We did not affect the wetland. By the Luera, is not entirely a wetland, all of it. Luera is a place of floodplains, wetlands, drylands, and whatever. It's a big conurbation because you don't know where at certain times. So you start with the wetlands, you start with the floodplains, then you start with the drylands, the people settled, and so the peninsula. So it's a combination. So that's Luera. And I think the ecology of Luera, if you check it now, because the method that we introduced to, especially those who are extracting sand, we also now introduce a method of restoration, simultaneous extraction and restoration. And I think the ecology of the Luera will become even more fresher.
With the extraction of the sand?
No, now the restoration that is taking place. Because sand, again, is a resource. And you're talking about development in Uganda. Uganda has been on a pursuit to grow. The dams, the Karuma Dam, the Izimba Dam, these big roads, even the one, the road in Jinja, they needed sand. Not just sand, you use the gray sand you use in your village. They needed sand which is crystal. When you pick a crystal, it's almost colorless. That's the sand, high-grade sand. It's not available in Uganda, except Luera was one of the places where that sand was. Some sand in Bukakata, I mean in Lekalbat, but was salty. So it couldn't be. Or the only choice would have done, tell the companies, import sand. That was not a correct decision. We regulated the use of sand. And initially, we had issues. But when we gained the ground, no longer an issue.
So how is you said that you've embarked on a restoration process.
The owners.
How does that happen?
Okay. You apply for sand mining in an area for, say, 10 square kilometers. We tell you you can only excavate an area of 100 by 100 at one time. Extract the sand there. If you get sand, if you fail, whatever way, because failures are there. You can get sand or no sand. Whatever the case, whatever you do, put back that thing before you go to start digging the next one. So that sequential restoration is the one which we adopted. And not only as you restore it, you put back the plant system and allow the system to generate. So some of the old pits where sand was dug, sand is now full again. So I think it's a misunderstanding, but at least we had, some of us had experience and we had the scientific background knowing what was happening. But the general public was saying, oh,
we are still up in arms.
That's the road is collapsing. No, we had a lot of rain. Lot of rain, and the culverts that were there were not sufficient to transport water from this side to this side. And that's why there was those breakages, not because of sand mining.
Doctor, in other countries where urbanization is being fast-tracked, there, what they call the green environment projects, how far are we progressing as a country in Uganda?
Well, Kampala City Authority is one of those that is trying to bring the greenness, green environment, or a sustainable city in their intervention. You've seen them creating some streets to walk and whatever, and it's a lot of effort towards that. And I pray that the new cities that have come have a time to plan to become sustainable cities, because they are new cities. They have opportunity now to integrate their planning with the environment so that it is in tandem. We are going to work with them to provide them with the general information and also encourage them to see what others have done. And so the cities become livable, comfortable to the people living in the city and to the visitors. And one of the things that the government has done is to refuse the gazetting of forests. You know, most of the towns had forests. And all those people wanted those forests cut so that they can get plots. We have said no. You are not going to cut it. You are not going to convert. Actually, now you need these trees more as a city than before, so that you don't. If the cities, the trees, those forest reserves can become boundaries from one division to another, so that you plan your development correctly. Because you know it's a planning. Getting the greenness in is a planning. It's a planning function. So that will also apply to the industries that will come there. Are they going to pollute and whatever? You saw during the COVID time, we also had a learning period here, very good learning period, because the people said, before they say air pollution of Kampala, industry, but every time we check industry, we are complying. During COVID, what was missing? Vehicles, tuk-tuk, boda-boda, they were removed. What happened to the quality of Kampala? The air quality improved,
went up
60%, better than it was. So it confirmed our assertion that it is not the industries. The industries are very regulated. It is the vehicle emissions that are causing poor air quality in Kampala. So now, Minister of Works has reinstated the inspection.
Mandatory motor vehicle inspection.
Yeah, so that we can get, we try to get rid of those vehicles that are making our city bad.
But as that comes, you should also be aware that we are a developing country, and what probably me and my producer can afford is a DMC, which will remit.
No, actually, that's why it is important now for Kampala City or those in authority to introduce mass transport, so that you don't need to buy DMC to move. You first use a bus, so that you move with a bus from wherever you want, from here to Gwaisa and back. And most people in those countries, though, they don't have cars. You buy a car when it's only necessary. But why do you have to bring a DMC to ensure that you remain there in a developed country, poor air quality, sick, what? No. We need to change if we want to become if we're aspiring to become any status, middle-income or developed countries. Those are sacrifices that you have to make sure. So we need to get through that. The vehicles that come in have very good combustion. They're efficient. They're well serviced. Even your DMC, if you do it servicing very well, it can run. But you say, I go and service one part, that one's okay. You repair here, you choose. The mechanic is saying, you want to repair all this, you say, I don't have money.
Doctor, activists accuse NEMA of one of the things that the environmental activists, one of the things that they accuse NEMA of is using the environmental impact assessment reports as mere rituals that do not necessarily aimed at ensuring that the environment is protected.
That is not true. That's not
true. I'm talking about that the industries that regulate, all those bunkers that we follow them, that these are the conditions under which we gave you. You did not do it. Are you doing it? The road infrastructure projects that are being built. Those are talking about borrow pits and whatever. We regulate even road industry. Have you closed a borrow pit? Recently we had to bring one international contractor back to do correction. And they were not going to give him another job. So we had to do a correction that are done. So we do. Sometimes some activists imagine things. Or they want instantaneous, when you do this, this one happens. This is a system of work. We regulate all this. The mass for whatever we do regulate. So it's not true. It's not true. We actually, those are our tools of regulation. The first tool is assessment. The second is the plan that you put there. Then you follow it. Then you do audit. Then we do inspections. We do what? another battle of all things to make a decision.
But during this year's National Environment, International Environment Day, Uganda's theme was "Nature is Talking." We should listen. One would wonder what policies, as the executive director of NEMA, have you put in place to protect the environment? Because all signs this year indicate that we are not doing well in terms of conserving the environment.
Yes, we don't need a new policy. You see, what happens is nature is speaking, listen. The guys of Panda Pier, nature is speaking, listen. That's the message. It is speaking, listen to it. Don't say you are wise, because those are the consequences. Those ones have these consequences immediately, and whatever, they have immediate consequences. So it's a very good theme. We don't need another, which was derived from the theme of sustainability. The way that we have here, and the green, so everything is there. So it was just to fit in. But if you I've just given an example. Nature is speaking. Kavera, microplastics is becoming the disease, the most important environmental risk to human beings. Because now the microplastics is entering the food chains, is entering your bloodstreams. We don't know what is going to happen inside your body. So now, those who are championing for these plastics, now, when it reaches now that stage, you know that nobody is safe. Just like corona. Nobody is safe. You don't know where it's coming from. So we put plastic. Now plastics, microplastics, have been entered in the food chain. They're now in the bloodstreams.
Indeed, nature is speaking and we should listen. Doctor, we cannot continue this conversation. Thank you very much for making time to the show.
Yeah, okay.
Be sure to catch the checkpoint tomorrow, same time. Good night.